commandments which I command thee this day shall ye observe to do, that ye may live. And thou shalt remember all the way which the Lord thy God led thee. For the Lord thy God bringeth thee into a good land, a land of brooks of water, of fountains and depths that spring out of valleys and hills, a land of wheat and barley and vines and fig trees and pomegranates, a land of oil, olive, and honey. A land wherein thou shalt eat bread without scarceness, thou shalt not lack anything in it. A land whose stones are iron, and out of whose hills thou mayest dig brass. When thou hast eaten and art full, then thou shalt bless the Lord thy God for the good land which he hath given thee. Beware that thou forget not the Lord thy God in not keeping his commandments and his judgments, and his statutes, which I command thee this day, lest when thou hast eaten and art full, and hast built goodly houses, and dwelt therein, and when thy herds and thy flocks multiply, and thy silver and thy gold is multiplied, and all that thou hast is multiplied, then thine heart be lifted up, and thou forget the Lord thy God. And thou say in thine heart, my power and the might of mine hand hath gotten me this wealth. But thou shalt remember the Lord thy God, for it is he that giveth thee power to get wealth. And it shall be, if thou do at all forget the Lord thy God, and walk after other gods, and serve them, and worship them, I testify against you this day, that ye shall surely perish. As the nations which the Lord destroyeth before your face, so shall ye perish, because ye would not be obedient to the voice of the Lord your God. I want to just remind everyone of a few announcements. Again, today is Independence Day. We will just be having one service. That is our 10:30 service this morning that we are having right now. But we are going to be having our Wednesday evening prayer and Bible study service. Again, that's at 7 o'clock, and we're going through the book of 1 John. We also have youth programs for all of our children, so we're looking forward to that opportunity on Wednesday. Friday is the men's cookout, and it's going to be held at Ryan and Becky's home. And if you need directions or if you need help in getting there, please just see Ryan or Becky about that. And this is totally provided for by the church, so food and beverages are provided. You just need to come. You just need to be there. And by the way, guys, as I mentioned in the e-blast, if you want to invite someone, that would be wonderful. We're looking forward to the time of fellowship. Scott Henderson will be bringing the devotional for that evening. So if you can come at 5:30, if you can't make it by 5:30, be there whenever you can. I'm sure it will go a couple of hours, so we're looking forward to that. July 18th, 2 weeks from today, is our church business meeting. And we do have a couple of matters that we will be voting on, so I hope that each of you will be able to make it for that. Members and non-members, I want to invite the non-members as well to stay so that you can learn how our church does the business at hand. Our Vacation Bible School is coming up in just a few weeks, in fact 3 weeks from tomorrow morning it starts, and so we're looking forward to that, July 26th through the 30th. There is a closing program at 11:30 on Friday, July 30th, and so we'll be having a cookout at 12 o'clock. The cookout is open to everyone in our church. In fact, we want you to come. We want you to come because hopefully we'll see a lot of moms and dads of the kids that come during the week. We'll see them there, and so we want you to be able to be there to talk to them, to mingle with them, to get to know them, to build relationships with everyone that comes. So this is a plea for everyone to come to the closing program on July 30th. We'll also have some fun things going on for the kids that day. There will be a bouncy house, and there also will be a popcorn maker, so there will be a few fun things going on. So the EBS door hanger canvassing is going to be the Saturday before Vacation Bible School, and we have about 400 door hangers that advertise our Vacation Bible School, so we'd like to get those out into the area, so we'll be having a canvassing or a blitz, whatever you want to call it, and obviously we need a lot of people to help us with that. And there are still some slots available if you would like to volunteer to help for Vacation Bible School. We actually have several opportunities for you to help. So if you're interested at all in any of that, please see me today. Also, there is a note in our bulletin that we are going to be updating our church directory. That's already in the works. So we are updating our contact info sheets, and so they are right here and right down below here. Some of you have already received your contact info sheet, and all you're doing is just verifying the information, and if you need to make a correction, put that correction there, and then just put it back in the envelope. If there's no correction needed, just put everything's A-okay, and put it back in the envelope, and you're good to go. So if everyone can help us out with that, that would be wonderful. For our first hymn, hymn number 532, God of Our Fathers, we are going to sing each stanza. And if everyone would just allow the pianist to play the introduction there, you'll see those that opportunity there at the beginning of each stanza. So please allow the pianist to play the opening, and then we will begin singing.
Well, this is the 4th of July, Independence Day, Land of the Free, because of the brave. And this isn't on the itinerary, but those of you that have or are serving in the military, please stand at this time. I recognize you at this time. I don't know if you've done that in the past, but please stand if you have. Yes, Norm, you are one of them. Anybody else? Stand up, please. Stand. Yes. Because of these people that we do have freedom, so give them a hand. Stanzas, let's all stand, and before we stand, turn to your neighbor, stand, go ahead, stand, turn to your neighbor and say happy 4th, and I'm so glad that I said happy 4th.
Psalm chapter 40. Psalm 40, I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry. He brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock, and established my goings. And he hath put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. Many shall see it, and fear, and shall trust in the Lord. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust, and respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Many, O Lord my God, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to usward. They cannot be reckoned up in order unto thee. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. Burnt offering and sin offering hast thou not required. Then said I, Lo, I come. In the volume of the book it is written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips. O Lord, thou knowest. I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness and thy truth from the great congregation. Withhold not thou thy tender mercies from me, O Lord. Let thy loving kindness and thy truth continually preserve me. For innumerable evils have compassed me about. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me, so that I am not able to look up. They are more than the hairs of my head. Therefore, my heart faileth me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me, O Lord. Make haste to help me. Let them be ashamed and confounded together that seek after my soul to destroy it. Let them be driven backward and put to shame that wish me evil. Let them be desolate for a reward of their shame that say unto me, Aha, aha. Let all those that seek thee rejoice and be glad in thee. Let such as love thy salvation say continually, The Lord be magnified. And let's say verse 17 altogether. But I am poor and needy, yet the Lord thinketh upon me. Thou art my help and my deliverer. Make no tarrying, O my God. Father, we thank you for your goodness to us. We thank you for this day when we can observe the freedom that our country has. And we are thankful. The men and the women that have procured that freedom through their own lives. Father, we thank you for the freedom that we have because of Christ. We thank you that we who are free in Christ are free indeed. And Lord, we thank you that anyone in this room who repents, who turns from their sin and puts their faith and trust in Jesus Christ alone can also have that freedom from sin, the freedom to do right, the freedom to serve you, the freedom to follow you. Lord, we thank you for the opportunity today that we have to meet here this morning, the freedom we have to bring your word with us. The freedom to proclaim your word from this pulpit. We ask God that we would never take those freedoms lightly, that we would continue to be thankful for your many blessings to us. Father, we also thank you for other churches in our state. We thank you today for Faith Baptist Church in Waukesha. We pray for Pastor David Teasdale that you would encourage him today. We thank you that you gave them a good vacation Bible school last week, and we pray that you'll continue to give them much fruit for their labors. Lord, continue to provide for their needs. Continue to give wisdom, as I know they have some issues going on with the school and needing more helpers, teachers, needing more students. I just pray, Lord, that you would provide according to your perfect will. Father, I ask that you would also be with our missionaries. We thank you for them. We thank you for the Shevchenkos in France. We pray that you would continue to help them to remember you, to remember your calling on their lives. We pray for their children as well, for David and Anna. We ask, God, that you would help them to really desire to follow you, even in their youth. We pray, Lord, that you would help them to know your will and to do your will from the heart. Lord, we also thank you for Eric and Katie Graham as they minister in South Africa. We pray, Father, that you would meet their needs today, encourage them, keep them close to you. Father, we also pray for the persecuted church around the world. Today we want to remember the Christians who are in southern Mexico and the Christians who are in Cuba. We ask, God, that you would protect them from harm. We pray that they would continue to remember that greater is he who is in us than he who is in the world. And Father, remind them of your goodness, even in the land of the living. So, Father, we also pray that you'd be with our country. Father, we ask that you'd be with our president, that you would work in his heart and life. Be with President Biden, that you might soften his heart toward the things of you so that he can believe and be saved. Father, we also pray for our Vice President Kamala Harris, that she too would turn from her sin and believe. We pray for our Governor, Governor Evers, that he also would be convicted. Lord, help us to remember to pray for those who are in authority over us, that we might lead a quiet and a peaceable life. Father, we do again thank you for the privilege that you've given to us now to be here. We pray that we would use the gifts that you have given to all of your children to edify the body of Christ. Lord, we thank you for our military. We thank you today for their service to our country. We thank you today for Anthony and for Jacob, for James and Shem. And we pray, Lord, that you would watch over them and protect them and remind them that you are with them and will be with them. We ask, God, that you would continue to work in the hearts of these men. Lord, just help them to follow you and do your will. We ask, God, that you would be with our upcoming Vacation Bible School as we desire to have an opportunity to minister to many boys and girls and also moms and dads. We pray that you would send them our way. We pray, Lord, that we would be just a loving church toward them, that we would desire to just spread the good news of the gospel to anyone and all who come. Lord, we thank you for your power. We thank you for your mercy. We pray, Lord, today that you would conform us to your image, the image of your Son. And as we look into your word in just a few minutes, Father, we ask that you would help us to just pay attention to what you want us to learn from your word today. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Page 40, if you haven't already found it, page 40 Great is thy faithfulness. Verse 3 says, pardon for sin. If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins. Cleanse us from all unrighteousness, and then and peace that endureth forever. We'll sing the first and the last of Great is Thy Faithfulness, first and the last. Trust in Jesus. Verse 4. And I hope you mean it when you say. sing it. I'm so glad I learned to trust him, precious Jesus, Savior, friend. And I know that thou art with me, wilt be with me to the end. We'll sing verses 1 and 4 as well.
Children may be dismissed for children's church. The topic of the morning is trust in God. We're going to be looking at a few different verses. We won't be, as we normally do, remaining in one text of the scripture. Trust in God. Trust can also be translated confidence. Is your trust in God? You can also say, is my confidence in God? It's also referring to a feeling of confidence in regard to one's situation in their life. And so it's really then a security. Right? It's a security. The basis or the foundation should be our trust. It is a security then that comes from trusting solely in God. Do you have that today? Trust in God. Again, a feeling of confidence in regard to one's situation in life. Even in the Declaration of Independence, which was signed by 56 men from the Second Continental Congress, July 4th, 1776, 245 years ago. And this Declaration of Independence, as you can read the Church Connection yourself, but it has many references to God. And of course, I'm not saying that all of the signers were Christians, but the Declaration of Independence did contain biblical principles. There was a desire to depend on God. Yes, we were declaring in 1776 independence from a foreign power, British, all right? But it was clear in the Declaration of Independence that our dependence should be on God. In fact, at the end of the Declaration of Independence, we find these words: with a firm reliance on the protection of divine providence, we mutually pledge to each other our lives, our fortunes, and our sacred honor. And as you read the connection found in your bulletin, you can find out many of those 56, many were mentioned in the connection that they actually literally gave their lives. When they signed, they knew that freedom was not free. And so they were dependent on Almighty God. In fact, you also see other references at the beginning of the Declaration of Independence. It talks about how we, therefore, the representatives of the United States of America in General Congress, assembled appealing to the Supreme Judge of the world. Dependence on God. He goes on to say that these United Colonies are and of right ought to be free and independent states, and for the support of this declaration, with a firm, here it is again, reliance on the protection of divine providence. Supreme Judge of universe, divine providence, a trust or a confidence in God in regard to one's situation in life. So our basis, our foundation for a confident approach to life should be in God. Is it this morning? Are you fully trusting God? As a Christian, we'll talk in a few moments to those who are not yet Christians, who do not have any trust in God, in Christ even, for forgiveness of their sins. But first of all, for the Christian, the book of Proverbs actually contains a lot of truths from God's Word that are very clear about trusting in anything but God. Let's just look at a couple of those verses this morning. If you want to turn there, that's fine. But in Proverbs 11 and verse 28, here is an example of some things that unfortunately we'll trust in. Now, in just a few moments, we're going to look at some benefits to trusting God. We'll actually look at six today, six benefits to trusting God. But first of all, from Proverbs 11, 28, there are those that do not trust in God, but instead, Proverbs 11, 28 says, here's what they trust in. Again, I mentioned this is going to be different today. We're looking at several verses, not just staying in one text of Scripture. Proverbs 11, 28. Is this you? Is this you? He that trusteth in his riches shall fall, but the righteous, shall flourish as a branch. Those that trust in his riches shall fall. Again, in Proverbs. Proverbs has a lot to say about money. Proverbs has a lot to say about trust. Of course, King Solomon would have written these verses before his own heart was led astray. Proverbs 25 and verse 19 is something else that we are not to trust in. This would perhaps be a reference to a group, to maybe officials, right? To maybe those that make promises that they can not keep or they choose not to keep. But in Proverbs 25, 19, perhaps this could also be related to relatives. I think you can kind of just include a lot. Trust in friends, right? Look at Proverbs 25, 19. Again, if the definition of trust or confidence is a feeling of confidence with regard to one's situation in life, the security comes from trusting God. So the security does not come, Proverbs 11, 28, by trusting in our resources, our in riches, possessions. Now, Proverbs 25, 19, confidence in an unfaithful man in time of trouble. Well, it's not good, right? It's like a broken tooth. It's not fun to have. It's like a broken tooth and a foot out of joint. Neither one of those would be very fun to have, right? So confidence in unfaithful people, whether it's officials that have promised you the moon, whether it's relatives, whether it's friends, where does our trust, our confidence need to solely be placed? The basis, the foundation is in God. One more, not too far away, Proverbs 28 and 26. Proverbs 28, 26. What about our own selves, our own hearts? Pride. Pride can lead us to trust in our own hearts. And, well, Solomon doesn't mince words here. It's very clear to understand. Proverbs 28 and verse 26. He that trusteth, so all my confidence in his own heart is a fool. Is a fool. He that trusteth in his own heart. So are you trusting in your own resources instead of God today? Are you dependent on God? Or are you dependent on your resources to pull you through? Yes, God provides. Yes, he gives wealth. But we are not to forget God, as we have read this morning. And is your trust solely in people? Right? Yes, God can provide good friends and good Christians. I understand all that. Yes, thank the Lord for that, right? But is our trust in them to where we are elevating a person, an official, over God? And is our trust in ourselves? If we are trusting in ourselves, the Bible, I don't call anyone a fool, but the Bible says that we are a fool. He that trusteth in his own heart is a fool. So now I want to look at the benefits of trusting God. Benefits of trusting God. We are to trust God, right? Psalm 20, verse 7. Some trust in chariots and some in horses. Those would have been very valuable, very powerful in those days, right? Okay, we would probably put in a few other things in 2021 there. But here in the Old Testament, this is what they had. This is what people trusted in to get them through battle, right? Some trust in chariots and some in horses. Psalm 27 says, but we will remember the name of the Lord our God. Even though all that stuff is out there, all that powerful stuff that can do damage, that can inflict horror, punishment to the enemy, we are not going to forget God. We are not going to forget our divine helper, where our aid comes from. In Psalm 56:11, it says, in God have I put my trust. I will not be afraid. What can man do unto me? We have it on our coins. We have it on our bills, in our wallets. Okay? In God we trust. But do we solely place all of our confidence in God alone? Do we do that? Is our confidence in God? Proverbs chapter 3, if you want to turn there for just a moment. Proverbs chapter 3. The first of the six benefits that we actually gain when we trust God. Very familiar passage of scripture here in Proverbs chapter 3. We all know these verses, right? Trust in the Lord with all thy heart, and lean not unto thine own understanding. In all thy ways, acknowledge Him, God. he shall direct thy paths. So the first benefit to trusting God for us is understanding. Understanding in Proverbs chapter 3 and verse 5, it says to lean not unto your own understandings. That is the idea of your own self-reasonings. So the Lord wants us to be discerning. The Lord wants us to walk wisely. He wants us to have insight. And that's what this word refers to. Understanding refers to discernment, our insight. And when we trust God, He will give us that discernment. Right? If any man lack wisdom, let him ask of God. Because He, God, alone is able to give to all men liberally, right? He doesn't hold back. He doesn't upbraid, right? He gives to all men liberally. I'm currently reading a book entitled We Will Not Be Silenced by Erwin Lutzer. And in that book, he writes this: in Eden, the devil sold slavery to Adam and Eve, but called it independence. He sold them wisdom, but it turned out to be mental darkness. He put forth a beautiful vision of who they could become, but his offer was sweetly poisoned. He promised them fulfillment and gave them guilt. He appealed to their pride and gave them despair and an empty life. He promised like a god, lowercase g, but paid them like the devil he was. He promised again like a god, but paid them like the devil he was. So the devil comes along. Again, John 8:44 says he's a murderer. He's a liar from the beginning. He cannot speak the truth. He cannot do it at all. And he comes along and he tries to trick us. He tries to deceive us. So we need understanding. We need to trust God to give us that discernment, to give us that insight for our lives. Again, that feeling of confidence with regard to one's situation in life will come when we trust God. God will give us understanding. He will help us not to be deceived if we are reading His Word, trusting Him. God, I may not understand what situation I'm in, but I know who the devil is, and I know he's trying to tempt me, and I know he can only deceive. The devil can never bring any good to your life. Satan never brings goodness. He always brings evil to your life. So, I will trust God. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. With all thine heart. Lean not unto your own self-reasonings. Trust in the Lord with all thine heart. Lean not unto thine understanding. In all your ways acknowledge Him. He will direct your paths. What does it mean, of course, to trust in the Lord with all your heart? That is everything. All of your desires, your emotions, your will. Trust in the Lord with everything. Many things can dwell in our heart, right? Things like pride, idols. But good things can dwell in our hearts too, like joy. Thou hast put, Psalm 4:7, Thou hast put gladness in my heart. What else can dwell in our heart that's good? Wisdom. God can give us that, right? Proverbs 14:33. Again, reference from Proverbs. Wisdom resteth in the heart of him that hath understanding. That's an important verse. Wisdom resteth in the heart of him that hath understanding. So not my own self-reasonings. Not trusting in the resources. Not trusting solely in people, although they can be a help. Not trusting solely in my possessions, although God provides those possessions for you to use for Him and for His glory. But where is our dependence on God? Where is our reliance on God? Where is it? So the first benefit we have by trusting God is understanding. God will give you discernment. Who here does not need that? Who here does not need insight on what God wants you to do, how He wants you to live, how He wants you to treat someone, how He wants you to respond to a co-worker? I need understanding. I will trust you, God. And so, number two, also found from Proverbs chapter 3, verses 5 and 6, it says, He will make your path straight, And so number two, the second benefit to trusting God is the fact that He will direct our steps. He will direct our steps. The word for direct means to make straight. Right? Remember what Isaiah said, make straight in the desert, a highway for our God. Right? So here's the word that means to make straight. The definition is it denotes travel made safe by clearing and leveling the road. So making a straight path obviously is also a form of guidance. That is what God can do for His children. Those who trust Him, He will give you understanding, He will give you discernment, but He is also able to make straight your paths, right? Travel made safe by clearing and leveling the road. You just trust Him. God, I see all these obstacles in the way. I see what You clearly want me to do in my life, but I tell You, I don't know how to get there. That's where we just need to trust God. I don't know how You're going to provide. I don't know how You're going to deal with this situation. I've got this thing going on over here. I've got A, I've got B, I've got C and D, and all the way through the end of the alphabet. I just need to trust God. Why? Because He is able to make your paths straight. Know that, Christian. He's able to clear all of the rubble, all of the obstacles out of the way. So you can serve Him how He wants you to. It doesn't always mean that He might take something away that you think ought to be taken away. So one benefit to trusting God is understanding. Another is that He will direct our steps. And now in Proverbs chapter 14 and 20, verse 26, we find our third one. Proverbs 14 and verse 26. Proverbs 14 and 26. So when we trust in the Lord, we're not trusting in ourselves. We're not trusting in others solely. We're not trusting in our possessions and our resources. But when we trust in the Lord, thirdly, He gives His children strong confidence. Look in Proverbs chapter 14 and verse 26. In the fear of the Lord. So in awe and in respect of who He is, so we don't want to displease Him. We want to serve Him and love Him. After all He's done for me, right? How can I do less than give Him my best and live for Him completely after all He's done for me? We don't serve God out of a fear like we are afraid of Him, but we serve Him out of love. An awe and a respect. That's the meaning of fear. So, in the fear of the Lord, we're trusting Him in this way. We want to follow Him. We want to obey Him. There then will come to us strong confidence. Strong confidence. Again, it's not in ourselves. That's prideful. But it's in the Lord. I know what God wants me to do. And by God's grace, I'm going to do it with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind. I know how He wants me to live. And by God's grace, I'm going to do it with all my heart, with all my soul, with all my mind. So He gives us strong confidence. We can have this assurance, of course, that God works together, right? Romans 8, 28. All things together for the good of His own. And this will let us face the unknown future with confidence. Are you worried about the future right now? Are you scared? Or are you trusting God? Are you believing His promises that He has laid out in the Scriptures, everything He wants us to know, He has given to us in His Word. And so when we trust Him, we will receive understanding. When we trust Him, we will receive Him directing our steps. And when we trust Him, we will receive that confidence in the Lord. Again, it's not in ourselves, it's in the Lord. Hymn writer Francis Ridley Havergal kind of illustrated this idea, this concept, this attitude with these words. She wrote, "Great is God's faithfulness, and I will fear no evil about the future. There is no room for the word disappointment in the happy life of entire trust in Jesus and satisfaction with His perfect and glorious will." I love that. There's no room for the word disappointment in the happy life of entire trust in Jesus and satisfaction with His perfect and glorious will. trusting him? Has he given you confidence? Doesn't mean that we will always live without fear. Doesn't. Doesn't mean that we will always please the Lord. No. Jonah, prophet of God, did not always please the Lord. Jonah, prophet of God, like Peter, did not always trust the Lord, but followed his own instinct, what he believed should be done about his circumstance in life. But what are you doing? Are you trusting the Lord? For the first three benefits, the understanding he gives, he will direct your path, and he will give you confidence. You may not have all the questions answered, right? But he will give you confidence that you are on his path. You may not understand everything about the path, but he will give you the confidence that you are where he wants you to be for right now. He will lead you for tomorrow. Augustine said, trust the past to the mercy of God, the present to his love, and the future to his providence. Future to his providence. Well, number four, we'll just deal with number four briefly. Number four, we can turn back to Psalm 1. I know we looked at that scripture memory a couple of years ago for our church family, but the next benefit of trusting God is the fact that you will be happy. And what I mean by that is the biblical definition, you will be blessed by God. Blessed is the man, Psalm 1. Approved of God, right? That's the definition we gave back when we were looking at Psalm 1 for this word. It just doesn't mean happy, like when you watch the fireworks last night as we did, or when you eat some ice cream or something, right? That's not the meaning. Approved of God. Blessed is the man that walketh not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor standeth in the way of sinners, nor sitteth in the seat of the scornful. But his delight is in the law of the Lord, and in his law doth he meditate day and night. And we'll just read those two verses. Blessed is that man that chooses to trust me. Now, in that context, verse 1, he's not trusting in the pridely counsel of the ungodly. It doesn't mean that we can't go to an unsaved person about fixing our car or our finance. It doesn't mean anything like that at all. But what does the Bible say? Are we trusting the Lord and what the Bible says? Or are we saying, no, the Bible can't mean that. God can't mean that. And then we're going to someone who doesn't even know the Lord, going to him for counsel that God has already given us counsel about in his word. So the fourth blessing he gives is that he will bring us blessing, spiritual blessing, which really leads to the next one, number five. Look, turn to Proverbs chapter 28. Proverbs 28. It pleases God then, if we have the blessing of God, it pleases God when we trust him. But look in Proverbs chapter 28. And this is the fifth benefit of trusting God. Proverbs chapter 28. Proverbs chapter 28, verses 25 and 26. He that is of a proud heart stirreth up strife. The Bible has so much to say about pride. So much to say. It causes the downfall of many. It causes destruction. He that is of a proud heart stirreth up strife. All right? It never, never promotes unity. Pride never promotes unity. In a family, in the family of God. So he that is of a proud heart stirreth up strife, but he that putteth his trust, boy, here's the opposite, right? He that putteth his trust in the Lord shall be made fat. Talk about spiritually prospering. That's what it means there. And then verse 26, again, he that trusteth in his own heart is a fool, but whoso walketh wisely, he shall be delivered. So here again is another benefit of trusting in the Lord. It says he shall be made fat. It pictures the spiritual growth of the believer. You will experience spiritual growth when you trust God. When you believe him, right, all the way, as Spurgeon said regarding the sword up to the hilt, right? When you believe him all the way, not just a little, but all the way, you will experience spiritual growth. Again, it really goes back to that confidence that you will have as a believer, that you are, as best as you know, Your conscience, as Paul said, is clear between God and men. As best as you know, you're walking with Him, not in pride, but you're trying to live for Him, you're trying to please Him, you're trying to follow Him. You're going to fail. You're going to have to pick yourself up and say, God, I'm sorry, I failed, I sinned, but I want to follow You. There will be spiritual growth, and that is the fifth benefit to those who trust in God, the spiritual prosperity that He will give. Someone has said, faith sees the invisible, believes the incredible, and receives the impossible. So our trust in God is going to bring us spiritual gain. Again, I didn't say physical gain. It might. It could bring that. God can do that. He provides. He does all the time. But spiritually, we will be growing. Are we growing spiritually? Could it be that perhaps we're not growing spiritually because we are not depending on God? We are depending on other sources and leaving God out completely, or pushing Him down to second, third, fourth, and fifth place. Well, you're in Proverbs 28, so let's look at the last one. The sixth benefit, trusting God. Sixth benefit, Proverbs 28:1, and then we'll look at one verse from 29:25. 28:1, the wicked flee when no man pursueth, but the righteous are bold as a lion. 29 verse 25. An important verse. The fear of man, so that's the awe and respect, not of God, but of man. So man is first, God is way down here, right? The fear of man bringeth a snare, but whoso putteth his trust in the Lord shall be saved. So the sixth benefit, there it is in the verse, the believer will be saved. Saved from, well, the attacks of the world. My trust is in God. I'm not fearing man. My trust is in Him. I'm going to follow Him. The world obviously follows the ways of Satan. So for that reason, the world will hate often the children of God, those who walk with God. Believers may, maybe I should say will, face attacks from an ungodly world, often for no other reason than just the fact that they belong to God. But we are close to God. We are close to Him. So the world cannot do more to us than what God allows. We are safe. The fear of man, though, brings us a trap. It brings a snare. But whoever puts his trust in the Lord is safe. Daniel Webster said, faith puts God between us and our circumstances. Faith puts God between us and our circumstances. Have we forgotten to depend on God? I want to read again from Deuteronomy. We read a few of these verses at the beginning of the service this morning, but let me again remind us that unfortunately, instead of trusting God, we often forget Him. And no, we are not the children of Israel. I'm reading from Deuteronomy. But they forgot the God who took care of them and met their needs and provided for them, and it also can happen to us. Here's a few verses from Deuteronomy 4, 6, and 8. Only take heed to thyself and keep thy soul diligently. But take heed to thyself. Keep thy soul diligently, lest thou forget the things which thine eyes have seen, and lest they depart from the heart all the days of thy life. But teach them to thy sons and thy sons' sons. So we should be concerned that our children understand who God is. We should be concerned that our children know Him, and that they are trusting in Him. Then beware, beware. So be on guard, lest thou forget the Lord, which brought thee forth out of the land of Egypt from the house of bondage. And it shall be, if thou do at all forget the Lord thy God, and walk after other gods, and serve them, and worship them, I testify against you this day that ye shall surely perish. As the nations which the Lord destroyeth before your face, so shall ye perish. Because ye would not be obedient to the voice of the Lord your God. I read from Psalm chapter 40. And I would like us just to turn back to that passage for just a moment. Psalm chapter 40. There are some messianic verses in Psalm chapter 40. We're not going to look at those. But in Psalm chapter 40, David, this is a psalm of David, it's written for worship, for the church, for the place where believers met. David is reminding us of what God then is able to do. You can see the situation that David was in, right? What the Lord does for David is in these opening verses. How he was in a desperate situation, and he called out to God, he prayed to him. He brought me up, right? Verse 2, he brought me up also out of a horrible pit, out of a miry clay. So here he was in this situation that would have been dark and dank and damp. And he was sinking. All right, now think about you as a sinner. We're all born in sin. We're all born sinners. We're sinking right upon our birth, right? Because death passed upon all men, right? Passed on us too. And so we're sinking at birth. And so here is David, and we don't really know the actual context of what David is speaking of here, but perhaps he's talking about a physical situation, but I really believe that he's talking about what God has done for him. For us, it would be how God has saved us, right? Think about the horrible pit that sin is, and how God delivers us, right? So the situation David was in was an awful situation, but the Lord heard him. The Lord heard him. And he completely delivered him, right? He trusted in him to save him from that horrible situation. For us as sinners, we trust him. We put our faith in what Christ Jesus has done for us on the cross. We believe that he died for us. We believe that he offers forgiveness to us. Sinners, the just for the unjust. He cried out to God, and he took him out of a horrible situation. He completely delivered him. That is what God does for sinners. Complete deliverance. Complete deliverance. And there are those that would say he doesn't completely deliver, but he does. He completely sets you free from your sin. Free from sin to serve the Lord Jesus Christ. Those that are free through Jesus shall be free indeed, completely. It's done. Complete deliverance. God then goes on to elevate. He raises him up. He establishes him. The firm footing here is mentioned here, right? The stability, the security. There's that trust, right? That we can have by trusting in God. And then that's going to inspire joy. There's part of that confidence, I believe, right, that was already mentioned as a benefit. He had put a new song in my mouth. I don't have anything to sing about. If you're a Christian, you do. If you're a Christian, you have a lot to sing about because of the fact that you are in a desperate, horrible pit called sin. And by trusting in Christ alone, he brought you up out of that pit and set your feet on a rock and established our goings. And many are going to fear, right? Look in verse 4. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust. Verse 3 said, many shall see it, shall see that you're a changed person. You've got a song in your heart, song in your mouth. Many will fear and trust in the Lord. And then that theme of trust continues. Blessed is that man that maketh the Lord his trust. And some of what we've already covered. And respecteth not the proud, nor such as turn aside to lies. Trusting in him brings innumerable blessings. We know that. Because of verse 5, many, O Lord my God, are thy wonderful works which thou hast done, and thy thoughts which are to usward. They cannot be reckoned, an accounting term, right? They cannot be counted up. In order unto thee, God, you've done so much. If I would declare and speak of them, they are more than can be numbered. What does David do? David, in verse 4 especially, rejects every other object of confidence. My sole confidence is in God. Are you trusting completely in God? Fully in Him? One other quote, I've mentioned this one before, by Corrie ten Boom. Her family hid the Jews in the Holocaust in the 40s. Corrie ten Boom said, "Never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God." Never be afraid to trust an unknown future to a known God. Are you trusting God today? Christian, are you trusting solely in Him? Your confidence is in Him. And it's going to change like it did David, right? It's going to change the way you're living. It's going to change your song. You're going to have a new song to sing. You're going to have a new tune in your heart, right? It's not a tune of despair. It is a tune of hope. Does that describe you today, Christian? Are you trusting fully in God? Are you solely dependent on Him? If there's someone here today and as an unbeliever, you haven't placed your faith, your trust in Christ alone. Christ is the only way to God. Christ is the only way that you can be saved. By turning from your sin, recognizing I'm a sinner, recognize that God sent Jesus to die for me, and then admitting that you are a sinner, you're deserving of God's wrath, you're deserving of hell, you're deserving of separation away from God, and you say, "But God, I recognize that Jesus died for me so that I could have my sins forgiven, and I believe that with all my heart. I now turn from my sin and trust in Christ Jesus alone for salvation." If you do that today, the Bible says, "For whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved." You shall be saved. Let's bow our hearts and our heads in prayer at this time. If there is anyone here, no one looking around, if there is anyone here and you would honestly have to admit that you have no personal relationship with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, I tell you, there is some good news that's found in God's Word. The good news is that you can know Him. You can have a personal relationship with Him. You can walk with Him. He has promised to never leave you or forsake you. If there's anyone here today and you would like to talk to someone, I want to encourage you to talk to someone today. You can be free in Christ. You can have freedom from sin and death and hell because of what our Lord Jesus Christ has done for you. Come every soul by sin oppressed, there's mercy with the Lord. And He will surely give you rest by trusting in His Word. For the Christian, I want to encourage all of us. For all of us at times doubt. All of us at times do not have an awe and a respect of who God is. We forget God. We don't cast our complete dependence on Him. So for the Christian here today, I want to encourage you with the fact of 1 John 1:9, God is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. He will forgive our pride. He will forgive our misplaced priorities. Just talk to the Lord. Let's just allow a few moments. Perhaps the pianist could play just softly while we're praying. God has spoken to you in a certain way through the Word of God today. Would you respond? Would you talk to the Lord? Maybe you need to ask forgiveness from someone right here in this building. Maybe you need to do that now. If you need to be saved, please see me or someone here in our church. We would love to take a Bible, take God's Word, and show you how you can know. You can have assurance your salvation. One more time for the Lord. Thank you. Let's continue praying, talking to the Lord. He wants us, Christian, to trust Him. What area in our lives have we not been trusting Him in?
Glory, glory, hallelujah. Thank you this day to celebrate and be dependent on you.